as we shift and we make kind of a pivot into the real philosophy that most creationists think about, which is evolution. And I didn't want this film to be an anti-evolution film. I'm not a fan of evolution. I don't think it's the best explanation for things. I think animals do change, as Rob Carter and Todd would have said. But I think that it was the history that Darwin was trying to form is what the real problem is. It's not necessarily the methodology, although the methodology is problematic too. It's how it sits in that historical structure of long ages with death, all these aspects which are very not part of the biblical structure, which then led us into Rob Carter. And Rob Carter was our marine biologist who I knew had done a lot of work on genetics, which is a good fit suddenly to take us back to the computers mm-hmm. and the complexity of life. And that was, I feel like, it was neat to see your connection in computers with the genetic mm-hmm. mentality and the complexity of the design, which is really where all this is going back to.
Of course, it was fascinating, too, because we got to scuba dive.
That's right. I'd never scuba dived before either like that.
I hadn't either, and it's a totally different world down there. And, of course, Dr. Rob Carter's been down hundreds of times. But the most fascinating thing was his discussion about the wealth of genetic data. Mm-hmm. Data involving the DNA process and the coding within DNA and the role of genetics and all of that. And helping us understand that God had created the kinds, and those kinds were then endowed with this incredible genetic capacity. And that capacity allowed that kind to then become diverse within its kind, to become diverse, and that diversity, as we've talked about many, many times, it is the diversity that God created that brings him glory, because it's the unity of diversity that is glorious. And so these kinds, like the cat kind, that had within it the capacity to be genetically a leopard, to be genetically yep. a lion, to be genetically a house cat, and all of the different kinds of house cats that we have, and yet they're all cats. And that has not resulted from genetic mutation. That has resulted from the original genetic capacity, which meant, and we tried to talk about this in the film, which meant that we are now dealing with a program. We're dealing mm-hmm. with an instruction set that is mind-boggling. Remember, Dr. Carter was talking about four dimensions of this.
Yes, and a lot of people struggled with that. I even had a PhD come up to me afterward, and he watched it. Now, you know, that's really new stuff. He said, yeah. My students struggle because they're working just in proteins, and those pictures reminded me of proteins, but I had to explain to them, no, mm-hmm. this is a little bit of cutting-edge genetic work,
sure.
which is that our genetic code, and we even had a hard time showing this because you've got it in these chromosomes. Mm-hmm. When you get smaller and smaller, it starts to get to this fractal. That's a fractal coding, very, very small. So you've got, we went and found these, and you can go online and find these movies of real time. Basically, the two strands open up, they make the proteins and come back together. I mean, we're talking about something that's so fast in real time. And it doesn't even explain how this idea of that they're all interfolded mm-hmm. and how this right here next to that right there creates a new right. set of instructions.
That's right.
And I think that the reality is many people were like, well, what does that really mean? I don't think geneticists understand all that it means. That there's this constant nope. frontier yeah. being passed. Mm-hmm. They actually it means this and this and this and this. Because junk DNA, which came up, people had said for years, 98% of the genome is junk. And it comes from the evolutionary paradigm. They didn't understand what it did, so it must mm-hmm. be junk. And I was reading, again, a secular book that said this was one of the biggest, stupidest mistakes. It set us back a decade in genetic research because they brought an evolutionary paradigm that assumed the DNA right. had, if it evolved, mm-hmm. most of it must be totally useless, yeah. as opposed to a 98% usefulness or more. Mm-hmm. And we don't even still understand how it all works.
Right. Again, the paradigm of one that would say, okay, well, because this is a result of mutations, then we ought to have a whole lot of mistakes in here. We ought to have a lot of junk in here. As opposed to a Genesis paradigm that would say, no, this is the marvelous creation that is beyond our ability to even comprehend. Now, we also recognize that we live in a fallen world, and we do realize
there
that there
mutations.
Are mutations,
right.
And we can track those mutations, and that's a whole other discussion about the rate of mutation that we see within the human genome. But in general, the large sense, when we look at that genetic data, that the genesis paradigm said there's probably a reason for this. There's a function. We don't know what it is yet. And that's part of the thing, I think, that what Dr. Carter was telling us, is that not only do we have the linear functionality of this, but then we finally get to a 3D function where it means something different now when it folds up. So it's hard.
It's hard
to understand. Now that you can wrap this thing around and form a whole new instruction set, but then his whole issue that it's a fourth dimension, that now over time, so based, there is a time element now to where this even begins to change as well. So hopefully, we are at least helping people begin to sit
scratching
back
the surface
and say,
wow.
Wow.
Yeah. And
this
I think that's it. A wow is kind of the only thing you can say here. Yeah. And what I wanted to do, and we didn't get into as much in the film as I wanted to, just because of the time, and we talked to their folks about it, was that when you look at that complex structure that's all interlocking, and you see it again in the creature and all its systems, so you got the genome, then you have the creature, we have all these interlocking systems, whether ourselves are respiratory and circulatory and nervous, and we know that. But then you take that and put it in an ecosystem, and then you put that ecosystem with all the pieces, and you realize this crazy complex of systems biology, systems geology, in terms of the minerals and the things in the environment, the carbon cycle and the, as Kurt said, the molybdenum cycle. I mean, who talks about this? But it's there. Yep. Crazy cycles. You realize six-day creation. Creation in six consecutive, literal, 24-hour periods makes the most sense from an engineering perspective. Because you've got to have all these things together, and then all of a sudden put it together, and voila, there it is.
That's exactly right.
And I felt that's a really powerful argument for six-day creation, is that engineering of everything. You don't, the idea of a progressive layering of all this, everything we know, and what goes back to that computer idea, is never progressive. Yes, you may progress to put pieces together because we're slow, but when it's together, it's got to work, and you can't have a lot of pieces moving around.
Right. You can have a fruit tree. So, for example, you can have a fruit tree on day three.
Right.
But if you wait millions of years before you have the birds who help pollinate the fruit trees, then you have a problem. Why? Because you're missing a key element in the ecosystem.
That's right. It has to be there.
But if it's too late, it's later. The fruit tree isn't dying. It's dying. In fact, it's probably waiting in great anticipation for the arrival now of those creatures who are going to be a part of its the pollination and so on and so forth. So, exactly right. The only way that this makes sense, the only way for ecosystems to make sense in the way that God did it, is that it is compressed in a very short period of time, which we believe it is. If you all of a sudden then make that into millions and millions of years, and all of a sudden you can't have those ecosystems, you have to somehow fudge it with something else.
Oh, and you read the literature, and it's quite interesting to see how we get there. Because I think that's the thing. It reminds me of some of the science fiction I used to write. Well, this happened, and this happened, and this happened. It's like, you don't know that. And this is all, you're assuming this, and this is all based on that. So I find that people who poo-poo the Genesis account are often doing so, I think in many ways, is because they don't want to admit that the sheer complexity of the creation around them is so radically impossible to explain by some random, slow process. Right. It just can't do it.
And you know what? This brings us back again. I have to bring it up again.
Yep.
And that is the deep essence and criticality of relationships.
Right.
And that's what we see in these ecosystems, the ecosystems that Dr. Carter was talking about. And that's what just shouted out to me, again, was how not only do we have these relationships within the creature itself, We are filled with all of these different relationships. Those are systems that have relationships with themselves. The blood clotting mechanism is a system. Mm-hmm. It's a system of all of these diverse proteins and pieces and parts within them. And even the protein themselves are made up of systems. But that system is part of another set of systems. We are part of a larger system in the same way that the coral reef and the fish and the sea and the ocean, the air and the minerals and all of this, they all come together in the diversity, the high diversity of all these pieces and parts, all brought together in a system that works. And it doesn't work if you take one of them out. As I said, blood clotting mechanism, you take one of those factors out and you're hemophiliac.
That's right.